place looks worse than the projects.
It started out small.
It's got measles bumps. It's tick.
Vampires of the insect world.
A part of Mother Nature's wonder.
What's so inspiring about bugs and insects and snakes?
But then they grew.
Don't move. There's something on your back.
Get off now!
And grew.
Just don't touch it if you don't know what it is. Don't touch it. It attacked me.
Unimaginable.
Ticks do not get this big.
Unthinkable. Unbelievable.
There's a huge fire and a whole bunch of those tick things headed this way.
Where civilization ends. The nightmare begins.
Everybody get upstairs!
It's not nice to mess with Mother Nature.
Carl and Lou here from Games, Brains and a Head Banging Alive, GBHBL.com for short, checking out the horror movie known as Ticks. Also known as Infested, which both titles make sense. I like the fact that Ticks is quite on the nose, it's exactly what it is.
Was there another one called Infested?
There's other movies called like Infestation and stuff like that. I mean, it's one of those generic titles that anybody could really use. Doesn't say a lot, whereas Ticks.
That's a bit more old school, doesn't it? What the old school films would be called Killer Bugs, they'd be called exactly what
on the nose. Exactly, yeah. On the nose.
And like, you're trying to set up, Ticks, okay. Talking about Ticks?
Yeah.
Infested could be anything.
Infested with anything, really. Yeah. So I can see where it ran with Ticks. And it was released in 1993, and it is very much a 90s movie. I think it's a very early 90s. You could argue even late 80s. It encapsulates that style of filming, the sort of adventurous ideas of where you could be like, look, I've got this idea, and this is what we want to do, and we're going to acquire this, and want to do practical effects and stuff like that. And they were like, yeah, sweet, let's do it. You know, that bravery that existed back then, it fits amongst many other of these movies where it's like about a specific bug or something like that, whether it be a spider, whether it be a cockroach, whether it be a fucking slug. These are 10 a penny.
Yeah.
And I don't think like Ticks is an insta classic. Like, it's not one I'm like, oh, you must go see.
No.
Or anything like that. But I think if you've got the time and you've got whatever it is, 80 odd minutes spare.
Give it a go.
You could certainly do worse than this, thanks to as well the cast and seeing a number of actors in roles, on unexpected roles almost, and that's kind of cool as well. Plus, as we already said, it's got practical effects, and I think the latter portion of the movie, we're talking the last 15, goes so balls to the wall crazy in what it does that alone kind of makes it watching.
Yeah,
and you know, it's one of those where if you stop to think about it, particularly one aspect, if you stop to think it, you'd be like, what? How does that work?
Yeah, we don't question these films, I think.
You know, but
so don't dig too deep.
It's entertaining fun. Directed by Tony Randall, stars Peter Scolari, Seth Green, obviously very famous name there, Rosalind Allen, Amy Dolnes, Alfonso Ribeiro, and Clint Howard. Those last two names, obviously Alfonso, most famous for The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. He, of course, played Carlton. And I thought it was awesome to see him in a completely different role in the sense that it's not Carlton.
Definitely not.
Although, if you know Fresh Prince, it's almost impossible to take him seriously.
Yeah.
You know, unfortunately, he is an actor who is typecast.
Yeah.
It is what it is. And in this, playing the sort of inner city punk...
Hoodlum.
Yeah, however you want to call it. It just makes you laugh more than anything else. And you're like, you almost see it as Carlton trying to pretend to be a hoodlum rather than anything else.
Yeah, very kind of sort of drama school.
Yes. And he's not
seen.
Yeah. But the thing is, it's not bad.
No.
It's not bad. It's just simply put, oh, shut up, Carlton. And, you know, we're doing pulling a knife out and stuff like that.
It must be quite a difficult one for an actor. Because if you know him so well and like for such a beloved character, like when you say Carlton Fresh Prince, it's like, you know, he's so well loved. And then throughout your career, everyone's like, oh, Carlton again.
Yeah.
Like the whole thing, like, Lord of the Rings and things like that, like everyone looks at you and go, that's your Lord of the Rings. Harry Potter, things like that.
Of course, of course,
you
of course.
Big franchises that kind of make you a character.
Of course, and I'm in the belief that you know, you may not love that if you're an actor, the fact that that's what you're remembered for, but oh my God, never underappreciate the fact that you are known
and remembered
for that. Yeah. If you do something that's so iconic and so important, and I'd imagine that's the case with actually most. I don't want to talk ill of actors. I imagine that's most. You know, I kind of probably see it more like musicians things, where like Lemmy and Motorhead would say that he hated playing Aces of Spades by the, you know, after a certain period, but you know, did it for the fans and stuff like that, and so on. I'd imagine there's a lot of actors for that.
Yeah.
It's kind of like they're not going to sit there and be like, oh, if you approached most, I imagine, said, oh, I loved you in this role that you're quite iconic for.
Mm.
I can't see many going, oh yeah, but I did other stuff, and it's like, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And if they did that, I would think they were a dick, because
yeah.
like this person admires you, thinks knows you, knows your name, and it's made you a star for this role. And you're going to get pissy because they don't know your other less important work. Like, for example, here's a good example, Alfonso.
Mm.
I would love to turn around and say to him, hey man, I loved you in Ticks.
Yeah.
Just because I can be a nerd about that side of things. But truth be told, if I turn around and said, hey man, you know, Carlton was an amazing character. Fresh Prince was very important and relevant and very funny and clever and all these sort of things. I doubt he's going to be like, oh yeah, but come on man. I also did other roles. I was in a movie called Ticks.
Yeah.
He's not going to do that, you know?
But I think it kind of gives it element of cheese as well.
It
having
does.
like Seth Green
of course,
that, you know, obviously back when it filmed, not the same case, but when you watch it again you're like, oh, them two.
Yeah, yeah, because Seth Green is very young in this. His character is bland, his acting is average in this, to be honest. Nothing particularly special, and he would go on to do much, much better things, not just in an acting role but in a creator role obviously as well. You know. And of course, the last one is Clint Howard. Clint Howard, the iconic horror name, pops up just about everywhere. It's funny with Clint Howard. You kind of go, name me 10 Clint Howard movies. And you're like,
I can do two now.
Yeah, but then like, but this is what you end up doing. Because he's very rarely the star.
Yeah.
He's normally just in the movie. And, you know, you think, like I said, obviously we've got Evil Speak. And I think of Silent Night, Deadly Night 4. The Initiation's a weird one. House of the Dead.
Mm-hmm.
Lots and lots and lots of roles. He just pops up everywhere.
Yeah.
And him in this, he's got a minor role. An important role, but a minor one.
Yeah.
And we'll get started then, because he plays the drug dealer, Jarvis, who basically is growing marijuana. Illegal marijuana in some big-ass warehouse shed in the middle of the country. But, for whatever reasons, never explained, unimportant, he uses steroids to enhance the marijuana plants. Now, I've got to presume it must maybe, I don't know, enhance the flavour, enhance the potency.
Speed that it grows up.
Maybe all these sort of things. Yeah. But it that part's never explained why.
Yeah.
It just is. And in the opening kind of like montage with the credits, we kind of see the runoff of this operation has started to mutate local ticks so that this liquid has fallen onto tick eggs. And made them grow larger and stuff like that. You start off this way and it's like, okay, that's kind of cool. You see something like pulsating sacks, gooey liquid,
very
stuff like
'90s
that.
As well, I mean, like credits over something starting up.
Yeah, yeah.
But cool. It kind of like gets you like, okay, this is gooey, this kind of film. I like it.
I like it as well because I like having credits like that at the start because it's often the chance when you actually see the actors and like, oh, cool, Seth Green's in this. Oh, cool. Alfonso Ribeiro. Isn't this great? All that sort of things. Whereas obviously if they're just at the end, you ended up just walking away and stuff like that. So the kind of credits coming up, I have no problem with it. It's more my style. Tyler Burns, Seth Green's character. He's basically being sent to join an inner city wilderness project to conquer his fear of the woods, is what they say. So he's a nerdy kid.
Likes
being indoors. He had some thing where he lost his father in the woods when he was younger, and it's meant he's got this fear of it. His father kind of just literally just dumps him out of the van about it and is like, yo, see ya. And he just, it's weird because where the meeting point was is in some sort of like run down part of LA.
Yeah, it's not the best place to meet.
Yeah, like
really.
It's middle of the day, but it's just like it's a clearly desolate run down area. It's a weird place to be meeting
young adults as well.
Mm.
Why would you kind of you go to like maybe brightly lit car park?
Yeah.
A bit odd.
And it's there he actually runs into Daryl, aka Panic, which is Alfonso. His introduction, I mean, the line is that it's something like, they call me Panic because I never do.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, don't say that. That's just so bad.
I liked it.
And basically, he starts being mean to Seth Green, and he's effectively Tyler. He says to him, shoot. He plays basketball, so shoot into the rim. Mm. And if you get it, I'll let you live. Like, he's got a knife and all that. It's proper non-threatening. That's the thing. There's no part of you that ever comes across it. And it's supposed to be, though.
Yeah.
Here's the thing about panic. You're supposed to take him with a pinch of salt.
Yeah.
That he wants to live like this. He wants to be a badass and all that, but he's not quite as badass as he is. He has a dog with him as well, which kind of immediately tells you, you know, he's got at least a soft side to him if he has a dog. Obviously, Tyler makes the shot. There's more back and forth. But then we meet the leaders of this event, which is Holly, played by Rosalind Allen, and Charles, Peter Scolari. They pull up, speeding up in a van, and they get out. And that's where we find out, that's where you see Panic, the true side of him.
Yeah.
As he actually hugs Holly. He knows her, very friendly. And it's like, oh, yeah. And it feels quite natural.
Yeah, I like the sort of chemistry between them. And the fact, like, he's all threatening him, comes from, like, shooting hoops and stuff. And it's like, yeah, I never felt like he was going to be any kind of threat to anyone.
No.
But yeah, it's like the whole point of having inner city kind of trips like this, isn't it? Taking kids that on the verge, maybe, of kind of going down different paths, but they kind of scoop them up and take them out to campsites and stuff.
It completely makes sense. It's a perfectly reasonable reason for things to be happening. Especially as we've got the others. We've got Charles's daughter, Melissa, played by Virginia Keane. Dee Dee Davenport, that's Amy Dulnes. Rome Hernandez, played by Ray Oriel. And Kelly Mishimoto, played by Sina Dariot. Now, this group here, they don't get much to do. Yeah. They don't get much to do at all. There's a couple of lines here. I think probably Rome is probably the one who gets the most dialogue. There's a couple of scenes between Tyler and Melissa as well, but there's nothing of substance here. It's quickly established that Tyler, Panic, there's the two people we should be focusing on. Tyler, more than anything, considering he was the first face that appeared on the screen.
Yeah. The rest are just kind of like, it'd be weird if it was just a retreat with just two young kids.
Yeah, six makes sense. Yeah, absolutely. On the way, they stop at a store to get some supplies. It's there. They run into the characters of Sir. He's called Sir. He has no name. He's just referred to as Sir, even in the credits.
Yeah, he's bizarre.
Which was weird. That's Michael Medeiros. And Jerry, who's a kind of a local hick, bad teeth, that sort of thing. And he's played by Barry Lynch. It's Jerry, obviously, who harasses Melissa. But it's Sir, who's basically this dynamic. Let's talk about the dynamic between Sir and Jerry. Jerry's got the whole hick thing with his head bad teeth. What you kids doing around here? That shit.
Yep.
Sir portrays himself as being a bit more upper class almost. Mm. You know, talks a little bit posher, a little bit. But he's still got a sleazy look about him.
He's a bit odd, isn't he?
He's a weird character. It's not the best role, like, not the best acting. You talk about cheesiness. His character is cheesy.
Very cheesy.
Absolutely. Yeah. But yeah, so Sir tells them to leave, tells Jerry to leave Melissa alone, and they carry on. We go back towards Jarvis now, and his hamster is killed off screen by a tick, seemingly. And when Jerry looks into it, he gets attacked by a tick. We get lots of sort of jump cuts with these things running around and the scuttling and all that. And then you get a sort of one that jumps at the screen for a jump scare thing. And it's all practical effects as well. These are all like animatronic robot things.
I really appreciate that.
Really do. They look horrible. And the noise.
It's funny now when you watch films and they kind of go back to this kind of style, you're like, oh, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. That's one of the things why when we were going to watch it, I was like, look, one of the good things about this is it's all practical effects. This isn't a CG movie. You know, and I said, listen, you hear a lot of that tick running. And I really like it, the scuttling, So when Jarvis is scared by the tick that jumps forward, he steps back into a bear trap and falls down, obviously he's badly hurt. And as he's lying on the ground, like, slime drops in his face, and then you kind of see like a tick eggs that are stuck, big tick eggs dropping.
Yep.
And like he screams and then we cut away. The group arrive at the camp. And in the cabin, one of the cabins, Tyler, Panic and Rome find a huge tick egg inside the cupboard. And be honest, these are the parts of the movies where you're like, oh, really? They don't really seem to care that much.
Yeah.
Tyler smashes it up and crushes it and squashes it.
There would be people that run these cabins like, that you might contact that like probably responsible for them. Like if you have some sort of like rat outbreak or... Do you know what I mean? Like there'd be management companies or some sort of like...
There'd be someone.
You could kind of say, oh, okay, we'll call the guy that runs this... That owns this shack, or whatever, not shack, the cabin.
Forget even getting that far. That is a big fucking egg of something. Yeah. Of something.
And wood.
Something laid that egg. I'm out.
Yeah, I don't mess around with things like that.
Right, that's it. It's just kind of ignored and dismissed. They don't even really mention it to the Charles and... What's her face? I've forgotten her name. Charles and Holly. Yeah. Charles and Holly. That kind of speaks volumes about their characters. Do you know what they're here for? They're the disbelieving parents.
Yep.
They're that. They're that. You know, oh, Mum, Dad, I saw a ghost. And they're, that's what their role is here. We needed, obviously, some adults here to explain why these kids are here. It wouldn't work if they weren't there. But there's nothing of significance coming from them at all. And we've seen it even further when, during a hike, Melissa's attacked by a tick. It kind of gets onto her back on a T-shirt. Mm. And Tyler manages to kind of get it off with his stick. But obviously, when they tell Charles, Charles's like, well, it's the woods. These things are going to happen. And it's like,
no,
dude.
The size of it.
Dude, like, dude. I mean, even if that was a spider, you don't just go, oh, it's the woods. Yeah. That's a big fucking spider for the woods. It's
very 90s, though, because nowadays people take a picture of it going,
of course.
Look at the fucking size of this thing.
Yeah, and yeah.
Back then, it's like, no mobile. So it was just like, gives you just describe the size of it.
But things do ramp up as Panic's dog Brutus is attacked and killed by a tick. This is a pretty horrible scene when he finds his dog hurt and it's sort of lying down. Like, good acting by the dog. But it's pretty, pretty horrible. Mm. This really upsets Panic. Really upsets him enough that he just wants to leave. He just walks off. He goes. He doesn't tell the others he's going. I think he speaks to Tyler about it. And Tyler says he won't say anything or something like that. And Panic wanders off. While Tyler and Charles go to the veterinarians with Brutus's body. And this is one of my favourite scenes of it. Mm. At the vets.
Yeah.
So she wants to draw some blood from the dead body because she can see like a wound and so on. Mm. But every time she kind of like pulls the blood out, it's like it gets sucked back in.
Yep.
There's a tick in it. Mm. After a couple of times of trying that, the body sort of starts to shake and rumble and all that. And she manages to pull a needle out and it's in the body of a tick. Like I said, easily the size of my hand. Mm. Easily the size of my hand. Yeah. But it's still alive as it starts running around the room, scuttling away with the needle in its back and so on. And eventually the vet just stomps it and crushes it. Yeah. All practical effects again, all
really well done.
Juicy, gory. But when the tick is crushed as well, whatever they used and how they did that, it's all slimy and gross.
They say having a pet's a good vehicle to kind of get the story going, because you do have to get outside help, you know.
Mm.
Dogs being killed and stuff like that, you know, you would go to... It's like someone getting injured. When they go to the doctors, like, it kind of moves the story forward a little bit.
It you're absolutely right. This is simply about moving a step forward, making it so that Charles is a little bit more seeing something happening, making it a bigger issue, killing off a pet, even though the dog wasn't in enough scenes to really have that
emotional
pull. I felt for Panic because Alfonso does act very, very well in this how he's upset about it. But it needed a bit more on that front. But it is just simply about, let's move this story forward. Mm. We need it to do that.
Yep.
And you're talking about Panic walking through the woods, is actually attacked by a tick. It kind of gels up his trouser leg.
Mm.
And he manages to pull it off, except his head, which kind of stays inside it. You kind of see it's like bubbled up under his skin. Again, good effects.
Yeah.
Pretty horrible. And he sells it really well. I actually really like the sell of this. Because, like, you expect him to be screaming and all that. But a lot of it isn't that. He's just going, like that kind of reaction.
Pain rather than,
not so much that, in the sense that it's probably not excruciating pain, but it's going to be painful. Yeah. So it's like, you know, that kind of reaction. I really liked it. Mm. Elsewhere, Kelly and Melissa had gone to go fishing, and they end up finding the sheriff, who had popped up in an earlier scene, talking about local marijuana farmers to try and keep them off other areas. Look, there's some local marijuana farmers. They might not take to appreciating you stumbling, this is all to tie into the original plot point, stumbling upon it. But they actually discover that his body's been killed. He was played by Rance Howard, and they find his corpse and his car has been like hidden.
Yeah.
So clearly someone meant to do it. It's an alright scene, that where the body pops up out of the water. It's a scare attempt, nothing really special about it. Dee Dee, wandering around, actually stumbles across one of these marijuana plants, Jarvis's place. And inside, she finds loads of tick eggs. And I love the scene where she pulls back the grating and they're all stuck to the wall. There's like loads of them. She gets up, annoyingly, like these huge eggs, and she's like, gets her face right up close to it.
That never ends well for anyone in films.
No, it's that thing. I mean, where would we be if people didn't stick their face into shit? Now, don't get me wrong, nothing happens to her here, but we do get some wicked POV shots of the tick inside.
Yeah.
And like her face on the other side. I thought that was a great little angle. She actually ends up kind of getting attacked by Jarvis, who's had ticks inside his face and stuff. So his face is all deformed and grotesque, puffy and grotesque and stuff like that. And he's trying to ask her to help, begging her to kill him and stuff like that. But his face, one of them bursts out of his face, latches onto Dee Dee. Tyler arrives and helps out. Yeah. Hmm. Panic. Hurt. Really hurt. Staggering through, ends up stumbling onto Sir and Jerry's marijuana farm. And Sir ends up shooting Panic in the stomach here. But in the same part, he actually causes a forest fire. So hits a propane, because Panic starts to run off, hits a propane tank and starts a forest fire. Talk about moving the story forward.
Mm.
Here we go. This is moving the story forward to the finale.
Yep.
So yeah, the fire is raging and the group all takes shelter inside the cabin. I don't know why they think, you know. Oh, and part of that is because they're now seeing the ticks running around the forest. You get a lot of them running around in the forest. Yeah. You can kind of see them because of the fire. Sir and Jerry turn up. They're hurt. They've been attacked by ticks as well. Yeah. The fire is a real problem surrounding, keeping them in. But they let them in, thinking they're going to help them. Sir quickly reveals his evil intentions. Yeah. He's got a gun and stuff like that. Especially when Panic turns up and says that Sir shot him. Yeah. And then Panic dies. Which is, you know, yeah, okay.
It's a good scene. Yeah, it's quite sad they actually did that as well. They actually went with that rather than having them all like run off to sort of sunset together as a group.
No, of course. In fact, what they're going to do next is truly the most shocking part of the movie, I think, in regards to the character. So Sir, having been found, he shoots Charles. Jerry tries to take the van, but in the van, Jerry gets killed by ticks.
Yep.
Of course he does. But he also, in a great action scene, crashes the van through the front of the cabin. And again, like that's a stunt.
Yeah.
That's a stunt. And everyone has to dive out of the way and shit like that. And you're like, I mean, obviously it's probably stunt actors.
Yeah.
But still it's a good stunt. Yeah. You're talking about a big old van crashing through the front of the cabin. And that's enough to injure Sir and allow the rest to get away.
Yeah.
They all head upstairs thinking, let's get to higher ground, while Sir's stuck downstairs, hurt. Which brings us to the reason to watch this film. And the reason I think you should watch this film. Oh my God, they did this. Panic's corpse starts to jerk around. And again, Alfonso.
Great job.
Flinging his up like, but he still looks dead. I think that's what's really good. He looks dead. And then massive mandibles burst out of his knees and out of his, and then his head splits apart. Basically a giant tick the size of me standing up comes out of his body, and it splits up, and it's all practical effect. I can't oversell this one enough. This is a great effect. It's really horrible. That's gross, the whole mandibles bursting out of the knees, the face ripping apart, and even when it goes up close to do that, still looks like Alfonso.
Because I feel like a phobia of insects is something that happens in real life to people. So to amplify it to that extent is quite a feat. So I've seen it on films with cockroaches and things like that. You know, just that initial fear of something being giant and bursting out. It's like a nightmare for a lot of people. And it's just horrible to watch.
Yes. It plays on the idea of things inside you. Mm. It really, really does. And part of the reason, the film doesn't do a great job of explaining this. Because you might be like, well, how did that tick get so big? Is earlier on, when Panic had been shot and hurt, to try and, I don't know, help him, he found a supply of steroids. He injects himself with steroids. And maybe he still had that tick head in his body.
Oh,
so that's the link there. It doesn't make a lot of sense. That's not how it would work.
No.
Of course, and you could also say, well, how does the tick, considering the tick, it's not long and gangly, it's a body shape. How did that fit?
Then I say, like, when you remove ticks, if you don't remove a whole of it, it can carry on going.
No, of course, what I'm saying is, how did that size tick fit inside his body?
Yeah, I feel like you have to kind of suspend.
You do, that's the thing.
I know this film about ticks, so you have to kind of go, yeah, sure, why not?
It's what I said at the start. If you start picking it apart, yeah, you can find your flaws all over the place. But you've really got to just accept that this shit happens and enjoy it for what it really is. And I'm not knocking it at all. No. I love the sequence. When I saw this when I was a kid, and it always stood out. I always remembered that sequence more than anything else. The tick obviously kills Sir. The tick starts attacking him upstairs. They barricaded the door. Ron gets caught by the tick here, particularly when they're all trying to escape at the window. And so basically the idea is, well, that it's a long, drawn out, not so much action scene, chase scene basically, where they're all trying to leave via the window. and so on. The Tinkerverse does eventually get to Rome, and Tyler goes back being a hero now to save Rome. He ends up setting the thing on fire. Again, the way this thing moves, it's slow, it's lumbering, it's an animatronic, but it works. Mm. Because, I mean, a tick of that size wouldn't potentially have the speed
of the little ones.
Of the little ones.
Yeah.
And of course, once they kill that giant tick and then drive back into civilization. But this is a 90s movie.
Oh, yeah.
A 90s monster movie. So you know it doesn't end there. As we see the truck, the van, now in a junkyard for whatever reason. Mm. In a junkyard for whatever reason. The camera goes down below, looks underneath, and you sort of see some slime. And then a tick egg falls to the ground. So suggesting that they're just going to it's gonna carry on, but in the city now. I would have liked ticks too. In Ticks 2, go to LA. Ticks 2, on holiday in LA. Do you know what I mean?
Like,
you know, taking pictures outside, stuff like that. Yeah, this is a... It's not a great movie all the way through. No. Like, this isn't, like we said at the start, this isn't an instant classic. This isn't where I'm like, oh, this is an 8 or a 9 out of 10. This is a solid 6 to 7 out of 10, based purely upon the concept of the ticks, the practical effects, and the ramping up it does... Like, stage by stage. Mm. The problem with that aspect, though, is that where it's like, okay, like going up gears. That's what it is. Mm. But they're not going up gears smoothly.
No.
So they're like, they're in first and they're pushing the car to the point where it already should have gone into number two.
Yeah.
And so, and each time it's doing that, where it's gone, they're in gear number two and the engine's sounding a bit shit and a bit like, oh, no, maybe go to gear three.
Yeah.
And then they do it. They needed to move gears faster. Yeah. There's not enough stuff going around the cabin story, like involving the wider town to make it feel either that threatening. It feels very localized. It feels very small.
More like, I say, if you had like a kids camp, would have been more.
Ooh,
I don't know,
that would have been
summer camp.
Risky,
you know?
Man.
If you want to, maybe have them a little bit younger and a few more of them. So maybe more like a.
I don't know. I don't know. That's a tough one to really say, you know, because
sometimes I feel a bit. Some of them seem a bit just really forced in.
Of course, so we've glossed over so many characters because they don't have characters.
No.
I mean, literally, we have Melissa, who doesn't like her father, like doesn't really get along with him. Never explained why.
No.
Just that, and then they're fine by the end. Dee Dee and Rome are boyfriend and girlfriend. Rome is a bit of a, hey, I'm a badass, that kind of thing, and she's just a pretty girl on his side. There's nothing about her. And Kelly is quiet.
Yeah.
Oh my God, you just reminded me. The random dropping in of the issue with Kelly. This, bear in mind, there's very little dark subjects here at all. Kelly, we find out in a very throwaway line, sequence and scene, she got raped. Do you remember that?
I can't remember that line.
Yeah, she got raped when she's talking to Melissa about it. She got raped when she was younger. It's part of why she kind of went inside herself and Charles and... God, I keep forgetting her name.
Holly
are trying to sort of help her come out of her shell and so on.
I can't remember that line.
Jesus, I completely forgot that.
Is that
added
just to kind of like remind them that's why they're pretty on in a city kind of like trip away to kind of like focus on stuff. But it just feels a bit like I wouldn't have.
No, there was no need for that. There was no need for that at all. Particularly when you weigh up that alongside Tyler, Seth Green's character of I'm here because I'm scared of the woods.
Yeah, just day and night.
Yeah.
Seriousness.
There's quite a bit of difference on that. Plot-wise, it's a monster movie. It's an insect monster movie. You're not expecting gold. You're not going to get it here. There isn't really that much of a story. It's just ticks somehow mutated via steroids and then go on a bit of a rampage.
Nice.
Character-wise, as we said, nothing of note there. The best one, really, the most developed, is Panic.
Yeah.
But even that, we're talking super, super light. Performance-wise, nothing terrible.
No.
Nothing outstanding either. This movie lives and dies on its practical effects.
Definitely.
That's it. And if you think, well, that doesn't sound like a great reason to watch it, I think give it a shot because barely a sequence goes by when there's not something it's showing.
Yeah.
Even if it's like irrelevant to the overall plot, be it just a ticking that's getting squashed or a random scuttling here and there, you do see some spectacular stuff for 1993. It's the last. To be honest, I think this is one of the last of that era because in a couple of years' time, we would get Scream. And that would rebirth a brief flurry of slasher horror movies followed by Blair Witch Project in 1999. Mm. So, see, look at Ticks in 1903. It's the last of a dying breed in that period.
Because I keep thinking Arachnophobia is 90s. It's not, is it?
No, I think it is. I think Arachnophobia is...
I thought it was 89.
Let me just check. So, like, we got...
Yeah, because I felt like... Yeah, because then it was like...
1990.
Ah.
Yeah, 1990.
So this was in one, yeah. So, it's like, then they had... So, like you said, they had those Lashash films that came back.
From 96, Screams onwards. And then, obviously, I Know What You Did... There was that brief boom. Scream 2, I Know What You Did Last Summer, Urban Legend. It was a boom. Then, obviously, Blair Witch, 1999, Shock the World. Then, in the early 2000s, horror just fell apart as everybody... tried to cash in on that continuing slash of craze.
And then there was a spate of disaster films, kind of in that similar sense of like over the top films.
In horror?
Not in horror, but.
I'm talking about horror.
Yeah, but just sort of like.
I'm talking about the era. So, like, yeah. I think there was. Between the years of like 2002 and 2005, there was very little of note. Mm. And then, of course, we would obviously hit brand back 2005 time, the torture porn craze. Saw, I suppose, actually. Saw was a franchise. Torture porn, yeah, you kind of. Attribute to the early noughties onwards, and then obviously we would hit 2000 and whatever it was, 2007, 2008 for Paranormal Activity, and then the rest was history.
I think Eight-Legged Freaks, but that was a throwback to old style films. That was a horror.
That was a comedy horror though.
Yeah.
I wouldn't, but they were 2002.
Like 2002, so they were going back to like cheesiness almost.
Yeah, that's all CG spiders with crap jokes.
Yeah.
Not a fan of that movie at all. But I am a fan of Ticks. So I do think you should definitely check it out if you've got the time. Thank you very much for watching. You can check us out on gbhbell.com as well as on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter and Tumblr. Go to Patreon to help us out over there. That's patreon.com/gbhbl as well as Big Cartel where you can find some of our merchandise. We have a podcast running on SoundCloud and Apple Podcasts. And of course, if you like this video, do us a favour, hit the subscribe button and help the channel grow. Games, horror and heavy metal, what else is life for?